If you would like to support the channel, then please turn off adblock and refresh the page. Alternatively, use the link in the description below to donate to T1 Patreon. Thank you. Hello YouTube, I'm T1GlistenerElf. As promised, the 4,000 sub AMA. If you got your question in, great. If not, don't worry, there'll be another one soon enough. 5,000, here we go. So, we're gonna start off with the ones that were on the actual YouTube video itself in the comments. Eben Green writes, "Is that your normal voice? Or is it just for the videos because, damn, son, it's smooth." Yeah, no. Kind of. No, not really. It's not like I'm consciously thinking of doing this voice, but this is obviously different than what you hear in the gameplay videos when I'm talking more like this. Part of it is just because this is easier to do. Part of it is because I don't like that voice because it sounds much more southern, and to me that sounds grating. Not southern, twangy, there's the word. But also, it's something, I answered this before, but I didn't give this piece of information because I didn't really see it in myself. I used to work for customer service, and they actually told me in training that I'm supposed to sound, they didn't use the word androgynous, but not too masculine or feminine. And the reason is because if you sound too masculine, and you can say that this isn't the way it should be, but this is the way it is. If you sound too masculine, then people take you as aggressive or overly assertive, and they don't listen to you. If you sound too feminine, you don't sound authoritative enough, and they don't listen to you. And so somewhere in between is where you're aiming for. I know that's kind of sad, but unfortunately, that's the kind of thing I'm sure they have done plenty of focus, or maybe they haven't, just it's become industry standard at this point. But yeah, so, and I also have a microphone this close to my face, so this just became the easiest way to go about doing both of those, not being so loud that is what you hear over the call, and also getting a nice, easy tone. The voice that I would use on the phone call was, for example, "Thank you for calling GE Appliances. My name is Jay. How can I help you today?" And if that if that sounds like it's not me at all, sorry. Alright, so yeah, that's that. The next one, Paul Petrie asked, "What are your plans for 2017 in YouTube and out?" Well, in YouTube, I would like to get to the point where I would like to have at least 10,000 subscribers. I like to have 5 digits. And I would like for it to, I'm operating under the assumption that this is never going to be a full-time job, and that's why you don't see me, you know, begging for money all the time, but, or ever? One time. But I would like for it to be a substantial enough hobby that even if it doesn't fully support me, it can buy some gifts for Eva. It can buy some gifts for my daughter. And I mean some gifts, not just some stuffed animals, like a new playhouse, or a swing set, or a trampoline, or just, if she wants something, I would have enough to be able to do that. So that's, I guess, I didn't think about wording it that way until just now, but I think that's the goal, for it to be my making my adorable baby happy fund. So if you watch one of my ads, if you turn off adblock, know that that's what you're funding. As for out of YouTube, this custody case is still ongoing, so once that gets settled, then we'll see. I'd like to go back to school. I'd like to go to grad school. Obviously, that's been put on hold for just a little bit. But I would like to better myself, get more education, and get into a more fulfilling field. Say that 5 times quickly. Next one. Armat, this isn't a question, but I mentioned in the last one that in the 4,000 sub announcement video that I was going to watch Genesis 4. And Eero says, "Armada is our lord." Armada's good, obviously. I personally think that he's the best melee player in the world right now. And that's because he hasn't been beaten by anyone outside of the top 6 since, I think it was Amza at Pound 4. Now, I know that that record kind of got broke. Originally, it was he hasn't been beaten by anyone outside the five gods, and then Leffen beat him, and so the goalpost has been shifted a bit. But S2J came so freaking close. But Armada's definitely not my least favorite of the five, or six. He's above Leffen, so we'll give him that. If you want to know what my who my least favorite is, maybe get that in the next AMA. What are your go-to decks in every format? Is it Infect, pretty much, or something spicy? Shoutouts if that was the reference you were trying to make to the Zelda CDI games. Good for you, good on you. Ideally Infect, my first inclination is to make Infect work in a format. If it can, great! If not, that doesn't mean that I go for the strategy that looks the most like Infect. I have an unhealthy affinity for... That's a weird word choice. An unhealthy liking for Infect. I play it in Legacy, I play it in Modern, I'm trying to make it work in Vintage, although I haven't really been dabbling in Vintage too much. And in Standard, it goes way off in another direction. What I'm currently playing is Land Destruction. Let me say, I try to make unusual archetypes work in Standard. Because it's the best breeding ground for all kinds of different strategies. It changes the most. And Land Destruction, I think, is good now. It may not be Tier 1, it's almost certainly not Tier 1, but it's good. With ramp and enough land... There are Volcanic Upheaval, that's not even one I include in my deck, Structural Distortion, Demolish, Creeping Mold, Reclaiming Vines, World Breaker. That's six Land Destruction spells off the top of my head, and I'm pretty sure there are more that you just don't play. And five of those are four mana. We're never getting Stone Rain back, but four mana. Okay, enough of that. Other decks I try to make work, Turbo Fog is also a janky one that comes up every now and then. Super Friend Control isn't really janky in the same way the first two are, but I like trying to play Super Friend Control. I like weird stuff like that. Rather than just, oh, another aggro, or oh, another mid-range deck. Or even a low-to-the-ground tempo deck. So, Infect unless it's Standard, and then I try to make something unusual work. I'm still a brewer at heart, even though I don't really have the cards to ever brew anymore. I love you to talk about the US market compared to Europe. This is from Silent MTG and more. Shoutouts to you. Go check out his channel. Most YouTubers only focus on the US. So, I'm not a finance channel, and I'm not really the guy to ask for that sort of advice. So instead of giving you some advice, because I don't want to mislead anyone, let me give you a little bit of trivia. Okay, so, and this is more so trivia for people on this side of the pond, I suppose. The first time that a set is released in... that's a weird way of putting it. I'm not sure exactly what the criteria was. I think it was the first core set that was released in another language, or in a given language, was black-bordered. So, Russian, for example, 9th edition was the first core set that Russian got, whereas here in the States and in Europe, 9th edition was white-bordered. In Russia, it was black-bordered. And that's why 9th edition Russian Blood Moons are so expensive, by the way. It's because they're the only black-bordered ones, other than foils. The first ones in Europe that were black-bordered was what we in the US call revised. It's where we get our four and black-border cards from. So, whereas here in the States, you got white-border Tropical Island from revised, and it's that really washed-out look. Over in Europe, say, if you want to get an Italian one, well, congratulations, it's black-bordered from the same set. So, there's a little bit of trivia there for you. Next one, have you ever thought of doing voiceovers? We'll get to that in just a second. I've only been part of your channel a few days, but really chuffed you've got to 4K. Okay, I guess I will answer that now. Yes, but I don't know that this... So, I work in radio again. I used to work in customer service, my voice was fine for that. I work in radio again. Now, granted, it's private radio, where you're supposed to talk like this! Or, not like that, but you get what I mean. You're supposed to be more energetic, more dynamic. That's not really my thing. And for a lot of voice acting positions, that is what you have to do. If I were on NPR, like, imagine if you were hearing this voice on NPR. Maybe that works, right? But it doesn't work for the kinds of, like, you're not going to find me voicing your favorite anime character in all likelihood. Probably not. I do dramatic readings. I had a radio show back at WUOG in Athens where that's what I did. I did dramatic readings late at night. And that's in addition to the D&D radio show. That was fun. And I have one on the channel with a few more I might do at some point. Just something nice and calm and soothing. Almost an ASMR voice for you. Or maybe it is, I don't know. Question. For an Infect multiplayer EDH deck, this is from Alexander Martins, between Atraxa Pillowfort and Scythrix Voltron, which one would you pick, and why? The word multiplayer is doing an awful lot of work in that sentence. Voltron decks in general aren't as good in multiplayer formats, because there are more players to potentially answer and target you. In one-on-one, that's a perfectly fine way to go about it, because you still only have to deal with the answers from one player. However, if you're trying to go wide, if you're trying to go the long game, I think that Atraxa does an excellent job. Hit them once, give them one poison counter, and then just sit back behind your pillow fort and slowly tick up. Plus, that's value from your super friends. Atraxa super. My Atraxa deck runs, I think it's 26 now, super friends, and only two infect cards. Just two. Blighted Agent, because it can't be blocked, and Septic Rats? It's the one that, when it enters the battlefield, gives a poison counter to everyone. So, you just give everyone a poison counter and start ticking up behind your nice little wall. Those are the only ones I have. Those are the only ones I usually need. The Super Friends do the rest of the work. They do the heavy lifting. Plus, once you drop a poison counter on someone, you're a target. With the Super Friends, maybe, but maybe not. It's a long-term threat, and so it's harder for people to see that, and it's like global warming here in the United States. This is a weird argument. Here in not just the United States, but in general, it's hard to take action immediately because the consequences are so far in the future that the need isn't often seen by short-term thinking businesses or politicians or even individuals. Okay, so there's that. I answered that and then some. Sorry. I wish I could give you money, but I am broke. Just want to say, okay, well, thank you. I appreciate that. Just turn off ad block. You're fine. And maybe share a video every now and then. You're good. You're good. Magic-related question. Who is your favorite planeswalker? Unrelated magic question. Why did you lose your beard? I didn't lose my beard. It goes up and down and up and down. If it's non-existent, then when I tickle kiss Evangeline, she likes it. If it's long like this, then when I tickle kiss her, it tickles her just a little bit. But if it's in that in-between stage, it's scruffy, it scratches. So I don't want it to be there. If I can make it past that point, we're good, and I have plenty of video evidence of the tickle kiss. The tickle kiss. That's all. And if it comes out, it isn't just for that. I don't like shaving. Sorry. Who is your favorite planeswalker? If we count the retcon, then this is nice and easy. It's Nissa. Nissa is my favorite. Green is my favorite color. She's, in my estimation, the epitome of... I know she's not really a Selesnya walker, but she feels more Selesnya to me than any of the others. Harmony, community, serenity, meditation, that sort of inner consciousness. Okay, I may be a little bit of a hippie at heart, I suppose. I think that that's, as opposed to the green of Garruk, that's aggressive and powerful and haunting and wanting, you know, that sort of, that's not really me. It's the monk, the D&D druid style that more appeals to me. In other words, I guess You'd say it's the calm side. She seems to me to be the most calm and self-aware of them. But of course, if we don't count the retcon, or if we put the two together, back when she was a horrible racist and a xenophobe, not so much. In that case, I would say it's Tamio. She's a scientist. She's an anthropologist and a biologist and a sociologist and a physicist and an astronomer. She is what happens when you take the scientific method and turn it into a character, and I very much appreciate that. I would get along. I would hope that Tammy and I would get along awfully well. Let's see. Whatever happened to that card game you wanted to create? That's a good question. The one where both players take their turns at the same time, if I remember correctly. Okay, the comprehensive rules are written. The first two sets are written. And one of the sets is, well, okay, there's, I guess, 2.5 sets. The last one is actually based off of Isaac Asimov's The Last Question. And so it's themed around that. If you're not familiar with The Last Question, it's available to read online for free. Go and check it out. It's just a short story. Shouldn't take you but a few minutes, I guess, to read. It's a great read. But the trick is funding. I have this much coding knowledge. I have absolutely none. And so I would have to, even with something like the Unity or Unreal Engine, there's still some coding I'm going to have to do. And right now, I don't have the time to teach myself, with everything else that's going on, I don't have the time to teach myself how to code and then go in through all the time to do all of that. What I was hoping to do is hire. I don't know. I don't know exactly how the process would work. Of course, you could hire someone if you had the money to do that, or getting interns or something to that effect to work under me and, and be directed on it. And yeah, there's venture capital. You could get an SBA loan, that sort of thing. But right now, I'm just not in a position to dedicate the time to either learn it myself and code the game myself and basically turn into the card game version of Yandere Dev, or to give other people the chance to do that. It's still there. It's still an idea. And if it ever comes to the point where I find that I can't do it, then I will release the I'll release the game's contents available for everyone so that someone can make a game out of it. If it comes to that point. And by the way, the game is called Mind Wide Open. So, there you go. Fun fact. There you have it. Now, James asked a question on Facebook. James Walker, shoutouts to you. Perhaps thoughts on the new Zodiacs and Tier Zero formats in general? Okay, so this is a Yu-Gi-Oh question, but hang on if you're a Magic fan, if you're a Magic follower. Hang on for just a sec, we'll get to more. So, a Tier Zero deck. I had previously done a video on Tier 1 decks. Well, okay, tiers in general. And I define a Tier 1 deck as it has a generally positive matchup spread and no terrible matches, meaning, yeah, you can have unfavorable ones, but only slightly so. For example, in Magic the Gathering, I guess in Modern, Jund is a deck that doesn't really have any terrible matches. I guess Tron, but I don't think Tron is even there nowadays with Fulminator Mage and Kolaghan's Command and Crumble to Dust, and Tron doesn't have Eye of Ugin anymore. I don't think it's anywhere near as bad as it used to be. So then a Tier 0 deck is one that has a positive matchup spread and no even slightly unfavorable matchups. It only loses to itself. And I mean that both in terms of it loses in the mirror and it loses to its own lack of consistency. In Yu-Gi-Oh, you don't have any mulligans. Well, I mean, you have Magical Mallet and Reload and stuff like that, but you don't have a natural mulligan. You draw your five, those are your five. No point in saying keep. And so they try. That's one reason why, and there are a number of reasons, but that's one reason why they can afford to make the game a little more combo-oriented. It's because players have to take that lack of consistency into consideration when building a deck. That being said,
Sometimes the combo is just too good. We talk about one card combos as being the best. I don't mean one card like Chicken a la King, which is broken. Not necessarily too strong, it just doesn't work. Yeah, okay, it is both. It's too strong as well. I'm talking about, like, for example, in Oops All Spells in Legacy. It's a deck that goes off on turn one because if you resolve a Balustrade Spy or an Undercity Informer, you just win the game on the spot. I guess you could kind of say it's a 60 card combo, but it's really only one. You resolve the one, and it's not Deceiver Exarch plus Splinter Twin. It would be like just needing to get the Deceiver Exarch out, and then you just win the game. Yu-Gi-Oh has something similar in Zodiacs, but in decks in general through the card Speedroid Terror Top. This is going to be limited, if not banned, in the next format, because if we think of Yu-Gi-Oh as a game that's all about card advantage, I think that Magic is about resource advantage or resource management. Yu-Gi-Oh is about card advantage. If this is in your opening hand and you're playing Zodiacs, you can actually get, I think it's a 10 for one. Let's see. Speedroid gets Speedroid, Overlay, Detach get Zodiac Marmoret? The rat thing. And then Overlay, Detach. It's a nice long combo, and it ends up being about a 10 for one by the time you're done. That actually seriously might be an underestimate. If this card is in your opening hand, it's ridiculous, and as a result, the deck is ridiculous. It is beyond insane. So, that is what do I think about decks like those? You can't let them survive for more than one format. It's like if they saw Treasure Cruise or Eye of Ugin in Eldrazi running around. You let them try for one format and have their fun, and then you ban the card that makes them most consequential in your estimation. There you go. Or I guess that's a bad way of putting it. In Yu-Gi-Oh, you just ban the card. In Magic, you could ban the card that's most consequential, or the one you think makes the softest nerf that balances the deck or the archetype. So you can still play Eldrazi, you just have to use only Temple, so it isn't as good, for instance. Okay, next one. At your peak, before real responsibilities, how much would you spend per month on Magic? Let's see. At my peak, there was a time when I wasn't married, didn't have a kid, nothing like that, but I did have a job. And so once I had enough money tucked away for school, I could spend it on whatever I wanted. And this was way back. This was 2011, like early 2011, I suppose. I was just getting back into Magic after my hiatus, and Legacy appealed to me. Well, as you can imagine, Legacy was much less expensive back then. And I, being the T1 Glistener Elf even back before the channel started, wanted to play Legacy Infect. I didn't purchase the cards individually over time, as a lot of people do, and probably would have been more cost efficient if I had done it that way. I ended up buying basically the whole deck all at once, which was pretty cool to be able to do, to be able to have. And because at the time I didn't have bills, well, that's fine. I had this weird list where I had one Gaia's Cradle in there. This was with the old Legend rules, so Gaia's Cradle was much cheaper. I don't know what I was thinking. I was silly. Okay. And if, I did borrow some cards as well for. Infect wasn't actually the first deck I ran at a Legacy tournament. I had to borrow cards to make crop rotation. Not crop rotation. 12 post work, but it was this Gruul 12 post. So instead of, say, Show and Tell to get Imrakul, I had Sneak Attack. And round one, my first opponent was Max Teets, who went on to win that tournament. He'd won the one before in SCG Atlanta. So he won that SCG Atlanta and the one before it on Goblins. I hope I'm saying his name correctly. I think it's Teetz, I think. And I didn't win, but I won a game with a turn two Imrakul off Sneak Attack. So I was proud of myself. I guess I should clarify then, just to make sure. I bought the Infect deck all at once, but I had bought cards for other stuff prior to that point. So I thought Cloud Post was pretty cool, so I bought my post lands. But I didn't buy like a whole 12 post deck, for instance. So there's that. I guess one little itty bitty thing, a little anecdote I want to get in, is that when I was married and my wife wanted to get into Legacy, I already had one. I already had a deck. And she was jealous and wanted to join in as well. Obviously, that's perfectly fine. Okay, honey, what do you want? Well, I don't know. Just as long as it's Rakdos. Okay, two things to note here. One, the fact that my favorite guild is Selesnya and hers is Rakdos should have been the first indicator. But in all seriousness, actually at the time, I could not think of any Legacy decks that were competitive that were Rakdos. If they were red and black, they were splashing another color. At least as far as I could remember. So Jund, for instance, or there was that Mardu Zombardment deck, or Grixis, say Grixis Delver Control. But I couldn't think of any that were just red and black. So what I did is I took a Sam Black Zombardment list, took out the white for Lingering Souls and whatever else he had in there, and what did I add in? I'm trying to remember what replaced those cards. Let's see. The creatures were Gravecrawler, Bloodghast, Dark Confidant, Deathrite? No, not Deathrite Shaman. Other cards were in there somewhere. And that was the deck that I ended up getting for her. Now, that was a pretty expensive purchase, but, you know, if you're purchasing it for someone else and it's a gift, you know, that's worth it. That's worth it. It's not for me, so I'm okay with that. And even though things didn't work out, we still had some good memories, so that's always fun. Let's see. Next question. This one is from, oh, by the way, that last one was from Andrew Ray. Shoutouts to Andrew. He's the T1 Glistener Elf in Athens now that I'm not there. He runs lots of Infect, and he's good at it. I was joking with him last time saying there can only be one T1 Glistener Elf. No, we're spreading the love. Phyrexia's spreading the love. All right, Bear Jordan asked the question, if you could have one move from any melee character, what would it be? And I clarified just to make sure, not added on to my main, which is Jigglypuff, just if you could have one move IRL. And I had to think about this for a while. My first inclination was to say Peach's Float, but that's not really a move. 3 seconds of being able to suspend yourself in the air, cover some wide gaps, that sort of thing. That seems pretty cool by me. Then I think the next one was Up Smash. Yeah, Fox's Up Smash. Because if I had Fox's Up Smash and a tail, then I could use all of his A moves IRL. Well, forward air, I can do two of the kicks before I have to land. He does a 5-kick tornado kick. I can't go that far, but I can do two. And I can just jump again to repeat it. I'm gonna call it a shuffled fair. That's my excuse, and I'm sticking with it. There are some characters where, so for Sheik, I can do all of Sheik's A moves if I could down smash IRL. That's a thing, I guess, if I could do the breakdance. What I actually settled, and there are a few others that are coming in pretty close contention, but what I settled on was a little unconventional, I suppose. If I were thrown into melee myself, this would not be the right choice, but IRL? Mewtwo's teleport, Mewtwo's up B, is actually where I would want to be. It's fairly long, it's fairly quick, gives Mewtwo, along with two pretty high double jumps, and a great recovery. And just being able to teleport IRL, let me go poof behind you, and I don't know, if I were a ninja, that would be cheating, but you know, you could do it. I don't think Mewtwo in the game can use it to go behind hard barriers, so I wouldn't be able to, let's say, pop into a bank vault and pop out. As fun as that might be, no. So it would still have its limits, but I think Mewtwo's teleport would be kind of sick, and I don't necessarily need one that's purely destructive, what am I going to do with a charged shot from Samus, or a missile, or even like Falco's laser? What am I going to do with stuff like that? They're so destructive, I'd rather have something that has more utility to it. Okay. That was Bear. Shoutouts to you. I'm going to play you in Athens when next I'm over. Christopher Long. Okay. First question. Is Oust a viable alternative to Path? So Oust is a one-mana sorcery from Rise of the Eldrazi. Put target creature second from the top of its owner's deck. That player gains 3 life. So, a few things to note here. Obviously, it's worse in that it's a sorcery speed card. I'm sorry. Dispel isn't that much of a deal. You want it to be an instant, ideally. So, we lose that utility, to be sure. It puts them second from the top. To me, that says you need to be a deck that can deal with them before they can get that card back, especially if it's something that is consequential enough that, say, it keeps you from winning. And the third thing is, they're gaining 3 life, so that makes number 2 a bit harder. Now, 3 life isn't much, but it's something. It can matter. But, situationally, I think that Oust is better. By that I mean an infect. Or at least it can be better. Path, of course, also gives them a land. That's a huge downside that a lot of people underestimate. Enough that people that I generally respect, Rogue Deck Builder, you put Path to Exile and Blood Moon in the same deck, not like mainboard, sideboard, in the mainboard together. Why? Why? No, it's fine. It's fine. If you're playing an Infect deck, you can deal with them, usually, before the card can come back. You can usually deal with them quickly enough. Kind of a thing you have to do. Infect gets creatures powerful enough that over the course of 2 turns, you should be good, you should be solid. Say if you're a Bant Infect list. Or even just Selesnya, even just green-white. Cards like Apostle's Blessing and Emergence Gate, unless you're playing against Eldrazi, can get you past their creatures and right on in, and along with your pump spells, you're golden. Also, you don't care at all about the 3 life. At all. I guess you could kill with Noble Hierarch. It's happened. I've done it before. The boss has done it before. I think I've seen him do it on camera, but I'm not 100% sure, so don't quote me on that. It's been a while if I have. Path to Exile, of course, is an instant. It has a lot more utility because of that, and it deals with the creature on a more permanent basis, so you don't have to worry about it coming back. Oust also gives them some virtual disadvantage. If you say, I don't know, first thing that comes to mind, say that you have an abundance of wealth in your hand, so much that you can oust their Birds of Paradise. Well, that can sometimes be better than bolting the bird, just because you're putting that bird back in their deck where it's going to be usually a dead draw. It's not what they want to be drawing on turn 3 of the game. Don't count that as the gospel. That's obviously not going to always be the best play. Maybe sometimes. Maybe. It's just another line for you that I think gets overlooked. Another alternative you can use is Condemn, which is an instant, but it only puts an attacking creature on the bottom of their deck. So it's terminus for one creature, but it has to be attacking. So for example, if you're playing against Malira, I think they're smart enough, they usually won't, say like Malira and company, they usually won't attack with Malira. That's Malira by herself is the reason why I run Oust. Maybe that's wrong, feel free to disagree, but that's the reason why. And it has definitely helped. It has given me a game back by being able to oust Malira. Next one. How about, what do you, as a customer of an LGS, want out of an LGS? Somebody over in the corner recording feature match. No. Shameless self-promotion. That's a good question. I don't know how to give the specifics of it, but it's the environment. It has to be an inviting environment. A place like I won't give its name. It's not Dragonstar Hobbies, and it's not Card Advantage. But it's another game store over in Athens. Does not have a very inviting atmosphere, and you haven't seen me record any games over there because the owner is not a terribly nice person. Or there's a store that I used to go to, and I actually used to record at, that the owner, I found out, was not a very nice person to others. He was nice to some, not to others. I didn't realize that exclusivity until after I left the store, or close to it. If you do, like, for example, what they do over at Tapstar, they're nice to you, they always welcome you, ask if they can do anything to help out. I don't know, I don't know how to say it. There's some secret sauce I'm missing, I think. How would you parse up inclusivity? What are the ingredients? I don't know the answer to that. What was that Supreme Court ruling? I don't know how to define it, but I know it when I see it. All right. And then, if money were not an option, what deck would you play in each format? Infect. Okay. No, in Legacy, yeah, Infect. Infect is, I guess, maybe lands. That's the only one that really competes, because of the way that's worded, if money were not an option. In other words, I could buy one of the most expensive decks in Magic outside of Vintage and play that. I might jump at the chance instead of Infect. I'm sorry, GlistenerElf, I love you, and I'd probably actually still take you, but I have to give him a chance just because of that wording. Vintage. Why am I jumping to Vintage? Just because it's salient, I just mentioned it. Some sort of Gush Bond deck, like a four-color Gush Bond deck that can win off of Tendrils of Agony. Sounds fun by me. I think, yeah, that would probably be it. If money were not an option, let me experiment with Infect first and see if I can make it work. And if so, yes, that would be it. If not, it would be Gush Bond. Few Pyromancers, or if I want to go five color, I could have it be Monastery Mentor. That would be sick. Steve Menendian, what, any recommendations? As long as I have Gush in the deck somewhere. It's one of my favorite cards in the game. Legal and Pauper, banned in Vintage, Legal and Pauper. Go and play it. Alright, and then for Modern, it would actually still be Infect. That one's just near and dear to me. I actually don't have enough cards to play a sanctioned Infect deck anymore without having to borrow. So, you won't be seeing as much Infect out of me, unfortunately, because I've had to sell off a lot of my collection. But that being the case, people around my LGS have been nice enough to play proxy games with me, or in some cases to just let me borrow cards, which is awesome. You guys rock. Standard. It would be Esper Super Friend Control. The mana base is expensive, planeswalkers are always expensive. I would want to be able to play a deck like that. If you've seen me play it on the channel, and I haven't since Aether Revolt came out, I very much like it, actually. So many decisions, every single turn. I love it. Alright. And then any other formats, EDH, Atraxa, I would want to be able to play. The least budget version of Atraxa that I could. Bunch of super friends, the land base, you know, that sort of thing. Otherwise, maybe the most pimped out Animar deck. Yeah, I should say for all of these, if money were not an issue, I'm foiling everything. Alright. And that's it. That's actually the last question that I have on here. I hope I didn't miss anything. If I did, please feel free to let me know and put it in the next AMA. When 5,000 comes around, we'll have another of these. So, until then, thank you for watching. I really appreciate all the support. If you have any suggestions for me, feel free to leave them in the comments. More gameplay, more deck techs, more vlogs are coming up. I will see you later. Take care. Bye-bye.